from Randy and Peggy Schutz. There is no Bible study tomorrow. The Mission Tribune are still looking for silent auction items. Items should be new and can be anything. This is the main fundraiser for the mission trip that is going to Denver, Colorado next summer. So if you have items or are willing to donate items, you can put them in PB's office. And we really appreciate your support of the youth. The women of Trinity are invited to join for the winter gathering this coming Saturday, December 3rd at 9 a.m. There's going to be a breakfast, some fellowship, and games. So you are invited to join for that. There are forms out in on the table in the narthex to order any poinsettias. They're $10 each year. There's a form attached, and you can leave money in the office if you would like to sign up for those as well. The Lefsa and Bake Sale and the Silent Auction is coming up on December 10th. That will be here before we know it. That will be from 9 to 3 here, and soup lunch will be served from 11 to 2. Also, if you are interested in helping to make Lefsa this year, need lots of help for that. There is a sign up on the table in the narthex as well. And one more announcement on the tree out in the narthex here, there are some tags. So if you are wanting to do some Christmas shopping for people in the community, for kids, there are tags with specific things on them that you can take and shop and bring back. Those are due back by December 12th. And I talked to Trudy, and she said you can just put everything in a bag and put the tag on the bag. So if you would like to check that out on the way out and help brighten someone's Christmas, that would be wonderful. I think those are all the announcements, unless anyone else has anything. Okay, let us stand as you are able as we sing our opening hymn. Come the long-expected Jesus, number 254.
Now.
will be lighting a candle each week as we prepare for Christmas, as we prepare for the birth of a king. And so I will invite Walter to come forward and light the first candle on our Advent wreath as we pray together. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for this evergreen crown that marks our days of preparation for Christ's Advent. As we light the first candle on this wreath, rouse us from sleep, that we may be ready to greet our Lord when he comes with all the saints and angels. Enlighten us with your grace, and prepare our hearts to welcome him with joy. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 25, verses 1 through 10. The psalms can be found after page 338 and before the hymns. We will be reading the psalm by half verse, meaning you all will read the indented portion. Psalm 25, verses 1 through 10. To you, O Lord,
I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame.
Nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame.
Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your ways, O Lord,
and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me.
For you are God.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love.
For they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions.
Remember me according to your steadfast love, and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord.
Therefore you teach sinners in your way.
You lead the lowly in justice.
And teach the lowly your way.
All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness.
To those who keep your covenant and your testimonies.
Our second reading comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. This is the word of the Lord. I invite you to stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel this morning comes from Luke, the 21st chapter. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then Jesus told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that the day catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated, and I will invite the kids to come forward for a children's message. Good morning, everyone. How are you all this morning? Good. So, question. How many of you have a hard time waiting for things? Like waiting for a party or Christmas? Me too. I have a hard time waiting for things sometimes. Sometimes we get impatient, right? We get frustrated if time seems to be dragging on and it takes forever to arrive. Waiting is really hard. And in this passage that I just read, Jesus' disciples are waiting, too. Because Jesus is telling them that the Son of Man, Jesus, will come back. But they don't know when. They don't know when, so they just have to wait. And this is a season right now, these 4 weeks that are... Yep. These 4 weeks before Christmas are called Advent. And it is also a time of waiting, right? We start to decorate the church for Christmas, right? We see people putting their trees up because we're all preparing to talk about what? What happens on Christmas? Yep. Jesus is born, right? That means Jesus comes to save us, to show us what love means, to show us and teach us so many great things about how we care for others, right? So how do you think Jesus' disciples were feeling while they were waiting? Impatient. What else? Do you think they were maybe scared a little bit? Maybe worried? Like, is he really going to come back? Right? But Jesus promises to be with them every step of the way. All right? And Jesus will be with you always. So let us pray. Can you repeat after me? Do you have a question? And what? God's buffet.
Birthday.
Birthday. God's birthday. Hybrid buffet. It is God's birthday. You're right. All right, will you all pray with me? Can you repeat after me next time out? All right. Dear God, we love you so much.
We love you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For sending Jesus,
to show us
what love means, so that we can love others. In your name we pray. Come get candy, one to keep, and one to... This is kind of like a little buffet, right? A little buffet All right, thanks for coming up. All right. I just wanted to send a buffet. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us. Love, forgiveness, and hope are within us. In the name of God, who sent Jesus and the Holy Spirit to show us that we matter and we are loved. Amen. Today's gospel reading from Luke is yet another apocalyptic passage that warns of times of discomfort, confusion, and distress among people and nations. You know, I'm beginning to think that PV plans be gone on these two Sundays that I've filled in, because they're both very scary texts, very cheery to preach on. But this text ends a little bit differently than the last time. You see, this passage starts out by speaking to the coming of the Son of Man, a promise that Jesus Christ would return and bring hope and comfort to his disciples and followers that would be left behind after his death and resurrection. And then Jesus tells this parable, the parable of the fig tree. He tells them to look at the fig tree, to pay attention to when the leaves sprout, and to take that as a sign that summer is near. Jesus then tells them to look around, to notice the things that are taking place around them. In Luke, this parable is told to the disciples right before the Last Supper, right before Jesus' final days with them. And he's telling them to wait and to watch. And he ends the parable with these words, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away." Jesus is speaking to the power of what is to come, and the promise that what Jesus has shown them, taught them, and instilled in them will never leave them. Even if there is distress, even if there is fear, even if there is confusion. Jesus is reminding them here that though times ahead may be challenging, they are never alone. And there will be signs of God's promises coming to them. He's reminding them that what he has taught them will strengthen them, empower them, and encourage them to live in the world as Jesus taught them. Jesus is telling them that he has equipped them to teach others, to show up for others, just as Jesus continues to show up for them in their waiting and when they need it most. I've always been one to give my all to school. I've gotten good grades, I've been a good student, and in seventh grade, I tested into the advanced math class taught by Mr. T. The year started off okay. I was keeping up with homework and keeping up in class. But as the year went along, I began to struggle. Things weren't making sense. I was struggling to understand what was being taught, and it was taking me longer and longer each night to do my homework. Frustration grew each night, often ending in tears because I felt like I was failing. I kept waiting and waiting for things to change, for something to click in my mind that would make things make sense. But I kept struggling. Mr. T knew I was struggling too. He saw me ask so many questions in class, and he saw my grades start to slip a little bit. And one night, while I was working on homework, I had reached a breaking point. I had no idea what I was doing, and I don't know if my parents knew how to help me with math either, or where we were going with that. Ready to give up and throw in the towel, though, my parents had a suggestion. Call Mr. T. Now, I was hesitant at first because, one, it was an evening, and he was at home. And two, I like to know what I'm doing, so asking for help is really hard for me sometimes. But I didn't know what else to do. I needed some sign that I could get through this class with a good grade, and maybe this was it. So my parents and I called up Mr. T. And for the next good chunk of time, he talked me through my homework so that I could understand it. He stayed on the phone until I understood. He He never gave up on me. And in that moment, not only taught me about altruism, but about compassion, about showing up for someone, about patience, and about hope. That night, Mr. T impacted my life more than I think he will ever know. I'll never forget how he showed up for me, and that kindness has stuck with me as I do my best to show up for others when they need a reminder of God's love and hope in the world. I thought about this story when I read these words from this parable that Jesus tells to his disciples. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Jesus is once again not promising them an easy road. Now, they might not be facing algebra or complex math problems, but he's preparing them for a new season in life, a time faced with impossible circumstances, with heartbreak and fear. Jesus is preparing them for his death, for his resurrection, and for new life through all of that. Here he is imploring them to remember all that they have learned and experienced along the way. The healings, the miracles, the sermons, the parables, all of it, that will stay with them even after Jesus has died on the cross. Jesus is preparing them for a time of waiting and giving them countless ways to find comfort and encouragement along the way. The season of Advent, the start of a new church year that starts today, is also a season of waiting. It's a season filled with light and hope as we wait for the birth of a king, a season that is meant to bring light into darkness, bringing the light of Jesus Christ into our hearts, and filling us with hope of a future where brokenness is made whole, where sorrow and grief is met with comfort and joy. A future where love invites us into eternal life in Jesus Christ, the coming of the Son of Man who will make all things new and fulfill God's promises to us. Sometimes the act of waiting can imply that something is passive. But in this case and in this parable, in our lives as Christians, waiting does not imply impassivity. It implies action. It is an active waiting. As we wait in hope, serving as the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. As we wait, we do the best we can to be Christ in the world for those who need to hear a word of hope, of love, of comfort. As we wait, we show up for others and show them the power of Christ's healing, the power of the resurrection that makes all things new, offering all of us the gift of faith that brings mercy, forgiveness, and love. And so Jesus is telling us to wait and to watch. Heaven and earth will pass away, but his words will not pass away. Jesus speaks to us the promise that what he has shown us, taught us, and instilled in us will never leave us, even if there is distress, even if there is fear, even if there is confusion. Jesus is reminding us here that though times ahead may be challenging, you are never alone. And there will be signs of God's promises coming to you. He is reminding us that what he has taught us will continue to strengthen us, empower us, and encourage us to live in the world as Jesus taught us. Jesus is telling us that he has equipped us to teach others, to show up for others, just as Jesus continues to show up for us in our waiting and when we need it most. For that, we can say thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing our hymn of the day, "The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came," number 265 in the red. God, we are thankful that you walk with us in the midst of our waiting. We ask that you continue to be with us each and every day, reminding us that we are not alone, and we have hope in Jesus Christ, the light in our darkness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of calling, you call us every day to love one another. Empower us to show up in our communities and care for the lost, the least, the forgotten, and the oppressed. Help us to love as fiercely as God loves us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of compassion, you know all our hurts and sorrows. Give healing to all who need it in body, mind, and soul, and inspire us to bring your love and compassion to all who suffer. Comfort those who mourn the loss of loved ones. We ask you to be with those whose names are on our hearts and minds and those known only to you. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, we pray for communities around the nation that have been impacted by violence. May you send your spirit of peace to all who suffer, to all who have lost loved ones to senseless acts of violence. In our brokenness and grief, send your love to mend what is broken, and empower us to act with courage against injustice and oppression. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we thank you for the joy we feel in this season. Help us to share your love with all those who need it, including ourselves. Remind us always that in the gift of faith you give to us, we have your mercy, forgiveness, and love. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord is with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share a sign of peace with your neighbor in whichever way is most comfortable, and then we will receive our offering. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
decorating the trees and making it look very Christmassy in here. So if you are able and willing to help out, we would love that. Mark? So we've got cupcakes this morning, correct?
Yep.
Looks like a mixed variety. All right. All right. 2-4-3-2-0-7-6. 2-4-3. All right. Enjoy, sir. It will be delicious. All right, and we will conclude with our closing hymn, 257. And I got to check because I think we're just singing a few verses. Verses 1 through 3 of 257.